are certainly a lot thin on the ground this morning. We have people literally all over the world at the moment. And we've got a number of people that I know why. That's a funny noise.
It's me.
Oh! Well, yesterday we had a speaker problem with that one that was making very funny noises. It's not doing it today, and I thought, oh, that's a different noise. It wasn't there yesterday. Anyway, so yes, we have a lot of people either away or not well. Mike and Gwen, they've got COVID again. They're not so good. So they're poorly. So there's quite a few people that we can pray for as we begin. But I would just like to say a couple of things before we pray. Thank you to those that made it on Friday morning. We made a little bit of headway into the tidying of the back end, a little bit, not a lot, but a bit. So it's begun. We will need to be clearing the kitchen soon. When I've got a definite date from the builder, then I will say that we need to clear it as soon as possible. But as I say, I'll let you know as soon as I know. And the only other thing is the encounter night will be next Sunday at 6 p.m. And next week, I would like us to think about this week a verse that God's blessed you with, or a short scripture, or something that God's spoken to you specifically that we can bring and share together to see what God is saying to us individually, but as a church as well. So that's to prepare for next Sunday evening for those who could make it next Sunday. I think that is the notices. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you. I thank you that we can put all of these things into your hands. And I thank you that there's nowhere better that we can come to. There's no one else that we can call upon but the name of the Lord. And we thank you as we come this morning. We know that you're here. We know that as we gather together, Lord, there's more than two or three. Lord, your promise is always there, that you are here in the midst of us. You are here, Lord, every moment of every day. Lord, help us to know your presence in a mighty way this morning. Help us to sense your moving of your spirit. Lord, we don't just want another time that we've met together. Lord, we want to be impacted by your Holy Spirit. We want to be spoken to. Lord, we want to reach out to you. And Lord, we ask that you would reach out and touch us as we push through in worship and praise this morning. Lord, we ask you to have your way in this place. For your glory, we ask it. Lord, we pray for all of those that couldn't be here for many, many different reasons. We pray that you'd be with them wherever they are, whatever they're doing, whatever the need is. We pray that you will be there with them as well. As you are with us, Lord, we pray that you will be there, and Lord, they will know your closeness also. Thank you, Lord, for your presence here again this morning, in your name. I ask it. Psalm 121 says, I will lift up my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He's not really asking the question as such. He knows the answer already. My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. So we don't need an appointment to see God. We don't need to wait until he's woken up. We don't need to ring a bell to wake him up. But God is awake. He doesn't sleep. He watches over us every moment of the day. Verse 5. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. Amen. We are thankful that God is a loving God, a God who cares for us and who watches over us. Amen. Shall we? We'll stand, for those who can stand, and we'll sing our first song as we come to worship. We'll take our tithes and offerings. Thank you. kingdom is. In the name of Jesus, Lord, build it, Lord, in this place, build it, Lord, in our hearts. Lord, let your kingdom come, Lord, on earth. Lord, oh Lord, we desire, Lord, for your kingdom to be established and be built and extended. And Lord, we ask that all that we do and all that we are, Lord, would be for your glory. Lord, we want to see your kingdom. Lord, you said that nothing could come against it. That nothing, that the gates of hell could come against it. Lord, we ask that you would build your kingdom here. Lord, let us know your kingdom. Let us see, Lord, the power of your kingdom on earth. Lord, we ask in the name of Jesus, we thank you. Lord, we thank you for who you are. Lord, we can't go anywhere else. Lord, we can't seek, Lord, another but you. And Lord, we thank you that you are worthy of all the praise and all the honor and all the glory that's due your name.
Thank you. us be better when going out than when coming in.
Yes.
Because, Lord, you are our great healer as well as our Saviour and our healer, our coming King. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Bless God. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, it's by your amazing grace, Lord, that we can stand. Lord, nothing that we can do, but Lord, your amazing grace we didn't even deserve. Lord, before the beginning of the world, Lord, you knew that we would be here this morning. You knew that we would be children of yours. Lord, you knew us before we were even born. Lord, and even that in itself just blows our minds. We can't understand that. But Lord, we thank you for your amazing grace, your amazing love to each one of us. Amen. Let's sing it. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind. sung and played this hymn hundreds, possibly thousands of times. Let those words sink in. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Saved a wretch like me, and it saved each one of us. Each one of us are here because of God's amazing grace in our lives. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Lord, I'm found. So thankful this morning that you found me, that you found, Lord, each one of us was blind, but now I see. Lord, that we were once blind and our eyes were away from you, that we couldn't see, but yet that day that you opened our eyes, that day that you opened our hearts, that day, Lord, that we accepted you as our Saviour, Lord, I thank you. Lord, what a great, glorious day that was. And Lord, we pray that we will see many, many more people, Lord, having that realization. Many, many more people having that experience with you, that their blind eyes will be opened, their bonds will be broken, that they will be set free, that, Lord, they will know your grace and your love and your mercy in their lives. Lord, our prayer, our heart's desire is that many, many more will come to you. Grasp, Lord, your infinite love for us. We cannot understand, Lord, how you would die for us, how you would give your life for us. But Lord, we are ever thankful. Lord, we cannot begin to earn it back, we cannot begin to pay it back. But Lord, we thank you that, Lord, it was a free gift. It was your gift of love to us. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see, Lord. Yeah. Thank you that you've taken those scales off, that you've removed those scales from our eyes. Yeah. Just like Saul on the road to Damascus, that you it was as though when he couldn't see, and then those they just fell away, and he became who you wanted him to be. Lord, I pray that you are making us who you want us to be. That, Lord, those scales of blindness will be removed. Those things that hinder us from hearing your word, that hearing your voice, that hinder us from seeing with your eyes of faith, Lord, that you would remove those things. That, Lord, we would be able to see and hear what you want us to see and hear.
Yes, amen.
Not naturally, but Lord, by your Spirit. Yes. Mm-hmm. We ask. In the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for your sacrifice that is beyond all understanding, beyond recognition. Lord, we thank you for what you did for us. We thank you for your love that held you to the cross. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he'd given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And Lord, we do ask a blessing on the bread and the cup this morning, Lord, as we take it today, Lord. Let us even, Lord, see a fresh revelation of who you are, a fresh glimpse, Lord, of your power, your majesty, your awesome glory, Lord. Let us see, Lord, with fresh eyes. Let us hear with fresh ears what your Spirit is saying to each one of us. And I'm going to come round with the bread and the cup. And there's a song that we actually heard on UCB, on Christian Radio on Wednesday. Never heard it before. And it's almost like a psalm. It's like a modern psalm. And it's written as a question and response. And the singer, the writer, he asks lots and lots of questions. And the backing singers, they bring the answer. And it's, can God do this? Is God that? And the answer is, he is. He is. And there's so many questions. And it's not as though he's asking a question to question God. But it's very, very powerful how the songwriter does this. So as we come and as we take the bread and the cup, Rick is going to play this for us. And if you want to watch, you can. The words come up on the screen. But it's a powerful song. It speaks to us in many different ways. So be blessed as we take the bread and the cup this morning as we listen to this song.
Thank you.
I've never heard that song before, but it's such a powerful, powerful song. And actually that person didn't write it, it was somebody else. But it was just such a powerful song when we heard it on the radio. We thought, yeah. So I just wanted to download it for us this morning. Beautiful song. Amen. Amen. I'm going to read from Psalm 77. And, you know, it's amazing when our minds, we think one thing, but God has something else. Because I generally like to preach from a nice little Bible story. I like to get a Bible story that is sort of half a chapter, a little story, couple of points, lovely, nice, clean, little sermon. And then God says, no, you're not doing that. Psalm 77, and remembering the goodness of God, and we'll come to a few things as we go on. Psalm 77. I cried out to God for help. I cried out to God to hear me. When I was in distress, I sought the Lord. At night, I stretched out untiring hands, and my soul refused to be comforted. I remembered you, O God, and I groaned. I mused, and my spirit grew faint. You kept me, my eyes from closing. I was too troubled to speak. I thought about the former days, the years of long ago. I remembered my songs in the night. My heart mused, and my spirit inquired. Will the Lord reject forever? Will he never show his favour again? Has his unfailing love vanished forever? Has his promise failed for all time? Has God forgotten to be merciful? Has he, in anger, withheld his compassion? Then I thought, to this I will appeal. The years of the right hand of the Most High, I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your miracles of long ago. I will meditate on all your works and consider all your mighty deeds. Your ways, O God, are holy. What God is so great as our God? You are the God who performs miracles. You display your power among the peoples. With your mighty arm, you redeemed your people, the descendants of Jacob and Joseph. The waters saw you, O God. The waters saw you and writhed. The very depths were convulsed. The clouds poured down water. The skies resounded with thunder. Your arrows flashed back and forth. Your thunder was heard in the whirlwind. Your lightning lit up the world. The earth trembled and quaked. Your path led through the sea. Your way through all the mighty waters, though your footprints were not seen. You led your people like a flock by the hand of Moses and Aaron. Lord, I pray for your word today. I pray that I would be able to give it how you would have it given. And Lord, I pray for our hearts to be open to your spirit, to hear what you are saying to us. And Lord, whichever part is applicable to us, I pray that I would hang on to it. And Lord, we would, Lord, chew upon it. We would meditate upon it. And we would, Lord, receive what you have for us today. This day, Lord, it's fresh manna, fresh bread. And we ask that you would speak to us afresh this morning. Amen. Amen. A beautiful, beautiful psalm. And again, a beautiful psalm that I wasn't going to preach on. I was going to preach on something else. And then God wants this morning. And it's amazing how it always works out that what you think is going to happen never does. So this psalm is a psalm of Asaph. And he is, or was, a great singer. He was a worship leader, a musician of David and Solomon's era. And he appears at different times in different psalms. And he was using the prophetic. I haven't read about him. Not that it sounds like a human person, doesn't it? Our Asaph. Obviously, it was a good few thousand years ago. So no, I didn't. But I've read about him, and he was used in the prophetic, and obviously in writing psalms and preparing worship for people in the temple. And he was prophetic in his compositions. And I just thought about, and this isn't a point, but when God takes our natural talents And he was obviously a talented singer, writer, musician. When God takes the talents of people and partners them up with the Holy Spirit, amazing things are birthed. You only have to think of hymn writers and songwriters and preachers and people who can't do it in themselves and can only do things so much. But then when God takes over, then amazing things happen. So, first thing, and I'm not going to go through verse by verse, but the first thing that I want to think about is, troubles will come, but where do we turn? We turn to God. And I think the psalmist here, I think he's being quite open. I think he's being honest. I don't think he's putting his mask on this day that he writes this. He's absolutely living in the real world, and he could well be living today. He's basically saying, I know, it's hard work, isn't it? There's a struggle. It's hard. We're in distress. There's all sorts of things. He's going, I don't know what's going on. He recognises that our lives don't follow a simple path. Things don't go perfect. There's twists and turns and a roller coaster of emotions and things that happen. And he's saying, I don't get it. I cried out to God for help because I didn't know where else to cry out to. I cried out to God in the days of trouble. I cry out to him. And Spurgeon says this, days of trouble must be days of prayer. In days of inward trouble, especially when God seems to have withdrawn from us, we must seek him and seek him till we find him. The psalmist, he's crying out, isn't he? He's crying out, he's desperate. Yeah, give ear to me, help, I'm crying out. I don't know where else to go, I don't know what else to do. In the trouble, he turns to God. We can't go anywhere better than to him. His cry was to God. It was urgent. He says, when I was in distress, in the day of trouble. So it's urgent. It's active because it says about stretching out. He's stretching out as much as he's stretching out to God. It's active. And he has untiring hands. Different versions say different things. But untiring hands, this version says, or without ceasing, another version says. So he's persistent. He's urgent. He's active. He's persistent in his desperation. He's crying out to God. He knows. He's saying to us today, you know, I understand it's hard going. Life is sometimes hard. Life is sometimes difficult. Life doesn't always go how you think. But I know someone who we can trust in. Life might not always be perfect, but I know who I can always depend upon. And he also goes on to say about, it's as almost as if God's left him, God's forgotten about him, God's gone away. I know you're there somewhere, he's almost saying, but I don't know where, I can't find you, I can't hear from you, I can't see. And how many of us have experienced that at least once in our lifetime? That God seems a million, million miles away, and yet he's just there. Yeah. But often, it's because we're either doing that, and he's there, or it's because there's something in the way that is blocking God. But God is always there. God is always there. It's just, are we hearing? Am I listening? Am I waiting? Am I expectant to hear from him? God doesn't go anywhere. Like I read earlier, he doesn't sleep. He doesn't have a snooze in an afternoon. He's there all the time. What Paul says in Romans 5, 1-5. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace. And just think about all of these brilliant words that we've got in here. In which we now stand, and we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, character, hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. So in that few verses there, we have faith, we have his peace, we have his grace, we can have hope, we can have perseverance, and it develops our character in God. Then we read about his love, which is poured out for us, and the Holy Spirit that God gave us. In the midst of turmoil, distress, and difficulty, we turn straight to God. And secondly, God has not forgotten you. And I know I started with this last week with a different psalm, and again it's come back in this psalm today. God has not forgotten you. I think Asaph felt like that. I think Asaph felt as though God had forgotten him. I think he felt that this season of dryness that he was maybe going through, this frustration, this whatever was going on, it might last forever. And it might last, and he asks loads of questions, doesn't he? And he's figured that he would never see the favour of God again. He would never see the mercy of God. He would never see the fulfilment of God's promise. And Asaph spoke these things that believers often keep to ourselves. People often keep these things and, we're fine. Absolutely lovely. Everything's fine. Everything's perfect. And I think God wants us to be real without emotions. And I think God wants us to be real with him. Because he knows our hearts anyway. And I think God's big enough to deal with our questions. I think God's big enough to deal with our sometimes doubts. I think God's big enough to deal with the things that we might think or we might emotionally feel. And there's many, many people. And if we had all day, we could probably go through every single Bible character who felt forgotten, who felt like God had said something but then completely left his promise. I mean, think about Abraham, when he promised him a son, but then it went on and on and on and on and on, and it was only old age that he had a son. Joseph, who was Joseph? I love the story of Joseph. Young lad who was a bit silly and a bit, shut his mouth off a bit, and he put in a pit by his brothers, sold into slavery, put in an Egyptian prison, rotting to death. And Joseph had had these dreams when he was younger, and he must have thought, God, you gave me these dreams, but where are you? You've forgotten me? I'm in this horrible prison with rats and snakes and scorpions and whatever else there would be there. Horrible place. Moses, who was an Egyptian prince, he was brought up as an Egyptian prince. And then what happened? He ran away, lived on the backside of the desert for years and years, and he might think, well, God's forgotten about me, I'll just finish my days over there with looking after the sheep, and I'll just... But no, Moses had a plan. God hadn't forgotten Moses. God hadn't forgotten. He hadn't been neglected. Gideon, hiding away in the winepress, hiding because the enemy were coming. All looked like they were forgotten. All looked like nobodies. All looked as though, from the natural viewpoint, that, well, they've gone. They passed it. They're too old. No, he can't be doing that. He's in prison. He's had it now. He's been in prison for, 14 years, was it? Or whatever it was. Oh, no, no way. Nah. But God says, no. I've got something for you. I haven't forgotten you. Whatever's going on, I haven't forgotten. This is your time now. And each one of them had their time when God said, right, now is your time. This is your time. Now is the time for deliverance. Now is the time to see your miracle. Now, that promise that I made you years and years and years ago, now it's on its way. This is the time. Get ready, because now I'm going to raise you up. He said to all of those and people throughout Scripture. And he's saying to us, those things that God has promised us, those things that he said to us, those things that have been in our hearts, God hasn't forgotten his word. God hasn't forgotten you, and he hasn't forgotten me. And anyone watching at home, God has not forgotten you. However far you think you are away from him, God has his eyes upon you. He hasn't forgotten. Isaiah 49:15 and 16, it says, can a mother forget the baby at the breast and have no compassion on the child she is born? Though she may forget, I will not forget you, God says. See, I have engraved you on the palms of my hands. Your walls are ever before me. We're engraved on the palms of his hands. God hasn't forgotten us. Even Jesus said in Matthew 28, and surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age. So troubles will come, but we turn to God. God hasn't forgotten you. And we remember the goodness of God. In this psalm, he's in a bad way. The psalmist is pouring out of how he feels. He's just writing how he's in this desperate situation. He's just so confused and just all of these emotions going through. And in the midst of this painful anguish, between what he believed and how he felt and he wasn't sure of what was going on, what does he do? He promises, he determines in his heart, and he says, I will remember the deeds of the Lord. I will remember the goodness of God. Whatever's gone on, I'm going to remember how good God is. Whatever's happened, I'm going to go back to that. Oh, yeah. I'm going to be determined in my heart. I will remember the goodness of God. He starts and he goes on and there will be better seasons. It will improve. Yes, there will. And he talks to himself. You know, there are times for that. I talk to myself all the time. I talk to the photocopy in school nicely, because if I don't talk to it nicely, then it won't work. And particularly on a Monday morning, photocopiers don't like working on a Monday morning. So I've often prayed over it. Come on, you can do this. And it's one of those things. Sometimes we have to remind ourselves of the goodness of God. We have to remember actually who God is and what God's done for us. He grasps firmly onto those memories, those things, those blessings he's had in the past. And he says, I will remember the goodness of God. I will. There's no God as great as you. You are a miracle working God. You display your power in the nations. Your hand of strength upholds and redeems us. Beautiful words. And then another psalm, Psalm 147, goes along a similar line. He says, praise the Lord, how good it is to sing praises to our God. How pleasant and fitting it is to praise him. The Lord builds up Jerusalem. He gathers the exiles of Israel. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. He determines the number of stars and calls them each by name. Great is our Lord and mighty in power. His understanding, and this bit completely jumped off the page, his understanding has no limit. Has no limit. That's Psalm 147. And in this psalm, I thought how the psalmist, similar idea to what Asaph was saying. Verse 3, he says, he heals the brokenhearted. That's a personal thing. He heals the brokenhearted. A personal relationship with God. And then verse 4, he jumps to, he determines the number of stars and calls them by name. So he's a personal God who we can have a relationship with. And yet, he knows every planet and every star and every body in the whole of the universe. Verse after verse, personal God, universal, mighty, powerful God. In two verses. And then, how's it finish in verse 5? His understanding has no limit. We cannot limit God. We cannot understand fully who God is. We cannot work him out. We can't, it doesn't matter how many Bible commentaries I read. Even then, it doesn't describe and it doesn't explain every single word of who God is, because he's just so, he's bigger than we can imagine. And when I was thinking about limits, and putting limits on or taking limits off. When I was at university, I used to love maths, and I do love teaching maths in school. One of my favourite subjects. And we did something called calculus. And for those who maybe years and years and years ago have done it, well, I would say it's not the most exciting thing in the world. And we spent 4 weeks waiting for a plum to drop off the tree. Now, it was when a plum drops off the tree, it has to be ripe enough to drop off the tree. We spent 4 weeks waiting for this plum to drop off. And we learned in the end of the 4 weeks, when dy by dx is zero, the plum is ripe enough and it will drop off the tree. And we waited 4 weeks. Yes, we did go to university to learn about the plum dropping off a tree. But what I was saying about that was that this part of maths always had limits. You always had to put the limits on, because if you didn't, it would be now impossible to do, or much, much harder to do. And you always had to have limits on, and this just reminded me of the plum dropping off the tree, that you have to have limits on to make it work. Well, with God, you actually don't have limits on. You cannot put limits on God, because he is limitless. His power is limitless. His understanding is limitless. His spirit is limitless. His love has no end. His goodness knows no bounds. Let's remember his goodness. Psalm 103, that David said, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, forget not all his benefits." And then those last verses, from verse 16 down to verse 20, he's talking about, he's reminding himself of the goodness of God when he brought the people of Israel out of Egypt and they crossed over the Red Sea and how they escaped from captivity. And these verses here, what a beautiful, beautiful picture of, and it just absolutely taught, just the majesty and the power and the greatness of God. It's just in every single word of that picture there, the beautiful poetic picture of the majesty of God, the power of God. I will remember, regardless of what's going on. The waters saw you, O God, the waters saw you and writhed. The very depths were convulsed. The clouds poured down water. The skies resounded with thunder. Your arrows flashed back and forth. Your thunder was heard in the whirlwind. Your lightning lit up the world. The earth trembled and quaked. Your path led through the sea. Your way through the mighty waves, though your footprints were not seen. So, remember the goodness of God. And finally, God makes the way. God makes the way. Verse 19, it said that you led the way through the sea. When God miraculously parted the waters of the Red Sea, it was as if a road had been made, a clear way through for the people to cross over to safety. God of the thunderstorm, of the earthquake, the wind, the fire, and yet he's also the God of the still small voice as well. So for us today, we've got that picture of the power of God. But we have even more than what the psalmist had then, because we know that Jesus has come as a fulfillment of prophecy. We know that Jesus has come and made the way for us, because he is the way, the truth, and the life. He has already made the way to come for us to come to God. Jesus made that way once and for all. And also, God makes the way where there doesn't seem to be a way. God makes the way in the desert. God makes the way in the wilderness. God makes the way in the dry and barren land where it seems unmanageable or even impossible. God will make a way, just like Jesus has done and has made the way for us to come to God. Isaiah 43, 18 and 19, nearly done. Forget the former things, do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the wasteland. I want me to trust that God is making a way.
Yes,
whatever we do, wherever we go, God will make the way. That I don't need to work everything out, because I just need to trust. And then he will take us the right way. We have to be obedient. We have to be honest. We have to put our trust in him, and God will lead us to where he is taking us. So, just in conclusion, we've got there. Troubles will come, but we can turn to God. God has not forgotten us. Remember the goodness of God, and God makes the way. Amen. Amen. And we are going to close with a final song, and we've sung it for a long time. So You Would Come. And it's, before the world began, you were on his mind. And every tear you cry is precious in his eyes. Because of his great love, he gave his only son. Everything was done so you would come. Come to the Father, though your gift is small. Broken hearts, broken lives, he will take them all. The power of the word, the power of his blood, everything was done so you would come.
Your presence this week, that we will know your blessing this week, that
that we will know your hand of provision upon our lives. And that, Lord, we will know that you are with us every moment of the day. Lord, we thank you for this time this morning. Go with us, go before us, be round about us. In your name and for your glory we ask it. Amen.